The two new therapies, telaprevir and bosaprevir, are work in a similar mechanism against the virus. They are both called protease inhibitor treatments. They do have slight differences in how they're administered and slight differences in their side effect profile and their success rates.
Telaprevir and bosaprevir are actually fairly similar medications because they act on the same area of the hepatitis C virus. There are some small differences. Some of the side effects are different between telaprevir and bosaprevir, and the efficacy in certain patient populations can be different when comparing the two medications. It's a very difficult decision to decide which medication a patient should be on. However, it is individualized for each patient. So depending on the comorbidities that the patient has, other medications, patient preference, and underlying disease of the hepatitis C, it's different for everybody which medication is more appropriate for each patient.
These drugs are currently available. They've both been approved by the Food and Drug Administration, and the FDA has made some slight changes in the paradigm for how these drugs are administered. They're both given three times a day, and it's important that they be given not morning, noon, and night, as we would typically think of a three-time-a-day drug, but every 8 hours. So there's a slight difference, and it's going to take a little more patient adherence to this for these strategies for them to work effectively. But both are available. They're both in the pharmacies, and we're anxious to get patients started right now.
Timing of treatment is a very important thing that's discussed between a doctor and a patient. Once again, this is very individualized from patient to patient. Some of the issues that will become important when discussing this with your doctor are the severity of the underlying disease. If your hepatitis C is very advanced, it might be important to start therapy sooner or later, rather than later. Another important factor is other medical problems that you have. Sometimes if other medical problems are very prominent and can be treated, it's best that this is done prior to starting hepatitis C therapy. Finally, there's a lot of contraindications for other medications that you're on during the course of hepatitis C therapy. It's important that a patient's doctor knows all these medications and appropriate substitutions can be made so that the patient can safely be on hepatitis C medicine with their other medications as well.
The issue, I think, in terms of who can start right now and who needs to wait a little bit will in part be due to the bottleneck of how many patients can actually be started at any one time. There's certainly enough drug to start many patients right now. The problem is manpower to treat the current patients that need treatment. Many patients have been waiting for years for these new drugs to be available. We know that we have about 750 patients that we've sent letters to about these new drugs, the new drugs availability, and we receive phone calls from almost 200 patients over the first several weeks after these new drugs are available. So our goal is to triage or to prioritize patients for treatment based on the severity of their need. Treat the sickest patients first who have been waiting and need this therapy to perhaps avoid a liver transplant. And patients with milder disease that can wait a little bit longer, we're going to have them wait a little longer and treat them a little later.
First, hepatitis C is a disease that takes 20, 30 years to cause scarring of the liver and to cause serious medical problems. So we've decided to offer treatment to the patients who have the most advanced disease. These are the patients that are most at risk for having short-term bad outcomes, such as decompensation of liver disease. These patients are going to be offered therapy first. Patients with very early stage of disease that can maybe safely wait a few months to years will be offered therapy after our sickest patients are safely started on therapy.
There are patients that, in spite of their need perhaps for these new therapies, are not candidates for the treatment. Either they've had a liver transplant or they have an HIV co-infection or they're on dialysis. Some of those patients won't necessarily be good candidates for this therapy or will be actually contraindicated where the FDA has said we should not use this treatment right now. Some of those patients we will try treatment on, but there are some that it's too dangerous to try this treatment. And those patients have an option of waiting for the next wave of therapies to come out, and perhaps without interferon, some of those patients may be treated. We may gain more information as some of these groups are treated in ongoing clinical trials. For example, there are trials for HIV patients. There are going to be trials for the liver transplant patient. So as we gain more information on how to treat these patients may then become candidates for therapy over time.